Watch what happens when I pour lighter fluid into this ring-shaped trough and then set light to it. Look, the flame goes round and round. Isn't that weird? I really wanted to figure out what was going on, and in doing so, I fell down a bit of a rabbit hole about things called excitable mediums. Excitable mediums are really interesting, and by the end, I had a handful of designs that made the flames do really bizarre things. This one in particular is a lot of fun, but first, why was I dousing my 3D prints in lighter fluid in the first place? Well, it's actually something one of my subscribers noticed, and they sent me an email. Rudy Stevens designed the part as a cap for a small closed ecosystem he was working on. To make it a snug fit, he decided to heat it up and mold it in place. Using lighter fluid for the task, he stumbled upon this weird phenomenon. So of course I said, that's amazing, please send me the file so I can try it for myself. And you know, it worked like a charm. But it got me thinking, is this trough optimal? Like, it can be quite hard to get the flame started, and it doesn't always burn for very long once it is. So I asked Oscar Morris to design me a parameterized CAD file so I could tweak the variables and see what effect that had. This is what Oscar does for a living, by the way, link to his website in the description. See how I can change the size of the trough, the width of the ring, the size of the opening. I can also change the angle of the opening. I wanted to have that ability because you'll notice in Rudy's design that the opening is pointing inward slightly, and I wondered if that was important. The first thing I varied was just the width of the trough, but I also varied the size of the ring slightly so I could nest them all together on the print bed and print them at the same time, but I don't think that made much of a difference. And it turns out there is a bit of a sweet spot around 5 millimeters. If the trough is too wide, the whole thing just catches fire instead of forming like a whizzing flame. And if the trough is too small, well, it works, but it doesn't last very long. With the width of the trough fixed at 5 millimeters, I then varied the size of the opening. With a very small opening, it's hard for the lighter fluid to catch on fire. When it does, you get a small flame that seems to travel very slowly for a short time and then go out. Conversely, if the trough is too open, the whole thing tends to set on fire instead of having a flame whizzing around. It's a bit like when the trough was too wide. You can get a whizzing flame eventually when there's only a bit of lighter fluid, but then it doesn't last very long. I also thought it would be interesting to try a small opening, but where the width of the trough is increased until that small opening is 5 millimeters, but it didn't do anything interesting. Like, it shows some of the same behavior, but just in little bursts, and it's not sustainable. Making the opening point inwards or outwards didn't seem to make a difference, and in the end, the optimum configuration seemed to be a trough that was 5 millimeters wide, with a semicircular cross section. I managed to get two flames going around at the same time at one point. Not sure how I managed that. So what's going on? Well, when you burn lighter fluid, you're not actually burning the liquid. Instead, because the lighter fluid is really volatile, it's constantly evaporating. That's why it has such a strong smell. So above this little pool of lighter fluid, there's a whole bunch of short chain hydrocarbon molecules whizzing about and mixing with the oxygen in the air. So when a flame is introduced, that mixture of hydrocarbon gas and oxygen ignites. The heat from the burning vapor increases the rate of evaporation so that you have a steady source of new vapor to keep the fire going. It's similar to how a candle works, actually, except that with a candle, the flame first melts the solid wax, which is then drawn up through the wick by capillary action, and then vaporized before being burnt in the air. My hypothesis is that when you have a very thin reservoir of lighter fluid like this, then you only have a thin ring of vapor above the liquid. So when it's ignited, the flame isn't as hot, which means the evaporation rate of the liquid fuel doesn't increase that much. And so the flame can't be maintained in that spot. But to the left and right of that initial flame, there's all this unburnt vapor. So you get two flames running around the ring, and they die when they meet at the opposite side. So that ring of vapor is a bit like a fuse arranged into a ring. If you light it at one point, it travels around. If you keep relighting it, eventually you get one flame going round on its own, presumably because of some imbalance in the reservoir or something like that. I had some success forcing a single flame by putting my hand over the ring just to one side of the ignition point, then quickly removing my hand after it had blocked one of the flames. But why does it keep going round and round? Well, brilliantly, in the time it takes for the flame to do one full circuit of the ring, enough lighter fluid has evaporated at the starting point for the flame to be able to continue. And so you get this flame that whizzes round and round and round. It's a bit like if you had a loop of fuse, but somehow by the time the flame got back round to where it started, the fuse had like regrown or something. It's like knocking down a loop of dominoes, except where you've got some mechanism running behind, putting them back up again. In other words, this mad contraption from JK Brickworks. Link to that video in the card and the description. The vapor explanation would also explain why it doesn't work particularly well when the trough is too wide. A wider trough means more vapor, which means a hotter flame, which means faster evaporation, and so the flame can maintain itself in that position. It also explains why a trough with high walls works better. It puts a bit of distance between the flame and the liquid so that the heat from the flame can't cause too much additional evaporation. That's compared to what we saw when the trough was shallow and the flame was just everywhere all at once. But presumably if you close the trough too much, then you have an issue with oxygen supply. Maybe. I'm not sure. So this ring of lighter fluid, it turns out, is an example of an excitable medium. An excitable medium is something that has the potential to switch to an excited state. In this case, it's the hydrocarbon vapor that has the potential to be on fire. That's not the full definition, though. There are three other criteria that make it an interesting subject. The first is that after it has been excited, it can't be excited again right away. The second characteristic is that after a certain amount of time, the medium is once again excitable. That's called the refractory time. And crucially, any part of the medium will become excited if a neighboring part of the medium is excited. It's such a simple definition, but it fully explains the fire going round and round the ring. And it's interesting that Rudy stumbled upon just the right parameters for an excitable medium to emerge, a thin enough channel so that the vapor isn't excitable immediately after it catches fire, and a ring with long enough circumference that by the time one circuit is completed, the refractory time of the medium has passed and the gas above the ring is once again excitable. It's kind of reminiscent of cellular automata, interesting movements that arise from simple rules. You're probably familiar with the game of life, for example, but this is a cellular automata model of an excitable medium, and it evolves in these interesting ways. There's lots of examples in biology. Signaling in organisms can often be modeled as an excitable medium. Heart fibrillation is an example of a pathological excitable medium. There's an infection called geographic tongue, and it's believed to be a very slow example of an excitable medium. The infection spreads, the tongue recovers, can't be infected again immediately, but after some refractory time, the infection can come back, and you get this complex pattern on the tongue. Someone called Ollie sent me this video of the bubbles on the surface of a hot chocolate collapsing. The bubbles are slowly evaporating, so they're ready to pop, which is to say they are excitable. And to some extent, each bubble is being supported by its neighboring bubbles. So if one bubble collapses, it's likely that the other bubbles around it will collapse, and so it spreads as this pulse wave across the surface of the hot chocolate. Sometimes you think, that's interesting enough for someone to write a paper about, and then you find out they already have. Mexican waves in sports stadiums are another example. The people are the excitable medium in that case. And just like with the lighter fluid ring, it's possible to get a wave that goes round and round and round. And forest fires. It's possible for a forest to be in the excited state of on fire. And it fulfills all the other criteria too. It's just that the refractory time is incredibly long. The forest has to regrow before another pulse wave can pass through it. On our podcast, Matt Parker asked the important question, how large would a ring-shaped forest need to be to sustain a continuous forest fire going round and round the ring forest, just like the flame going round and round the ring of lighter fluid? The podcast is called A Podcast of Unnecessary Detail, by the way, and one of our listeners went ahead and did the calculations. This is very rough, but the front of a forest fire progresses at about 10 kilometers per hour, which is surprisingly fast, actually. And some forest fires happen as often as annually, which means the refractory time can be as little as 1 year, or 8,760 hours. So if the fire front travels at 10 kilometers per hour and the refractory time of a forest is 8,760 hours, then the circumference of a ring-shaped forest would need to be 87,600 kilometers. The circumference of the Earth is less than half that at 40,000 kilometers. So if there was a forest all the way around the circumference of the Earth, it would not be long enough to sustain a never-ending fire that goes round and round and round. But I mean, you could zigzag the forest. Or maybe you could make the forest out of bamboo because that grows back quickly. But anyway, there you go. That is how excitable mediums can lead to spinning flames. Finally, I got Oscar to design a few more cool things for me. I wanted to see what would happen if the ring split in two and then came back together. That's cool, isn't it? It's interesting to see that you occasionally get, just very briefly, a sustained flame in one position, and it can cause other flames to change direction, or sometimes it can act almost like a spawning point, so you get more and more flames coming from that one location. And here's a spiral. And here's a figure eight shaped trough. I really didn't think this would work because obviously there's a raised section where one track goes over the other, so you have it slanting either side, and I thought the lighter fluid would drain away from there. Like, it definitely does, but I guess enough of the lighter fluid sticks around up there for the fire to go round and round at least a few times before it goes out. Then there's this design that has a flame going around a central ring, and every time it passes one of the arms, a flame shoots out across the arm. That's cool, isn't it? And here's a modification of the spiral. The issue with the spiral is it's not a closed loop, so you set fire to one end, it travels round and round until it reaches the other end, and then it stops. Wouldn't it be good if you could keep it going somehow? That's what the extra circle is for. The flame that goes round and round the circle should keep firing flames down the spiral. In reality, when you have these junctions, you often end up with a sustained flame at that junction, and that seems to be powering the continuous supply of flames around the spiral. But eventually, as the lighter fluid dries out more and more, the design works as intended. Now, there is still quite a bit of lighter fluid in the middle, so there's a bit of strange behavior there. It even sends one flame back in the opposite direction. If you want to print out any of these for yourself, there's a link in the description for that. Lighter fluid is dangerous, so that would be something for responsible adults only. And if you have any ideas for tracks that you would like to see, send me an email, tell me on my Discord server. For example, just before I was about to export this video, Rudy sent me another design. This is the flames solving a maze. How cool is that?
It's actually quite a nice t-shirt. Don't really go for science t-shirts, you know, it's quite subtle though.
This video is sponsored by Jane Street. Jane Street is a quantitative trading firm with offices in New York, London, Hong Kong, Amsterdam, and Singapore. They use techniques from machine learning, distributed systems, programmable hardware, and statistics to trade on markets around the world. They're also a bunch of people who love solving interesting problems, and they're passionate about a lot of the same things that we are. For an example of their nerdiness, they designed this t-shirt. Look, it shows like, how particles move in a cloud chamber. You know, if you've got like maybe a magnetic field and a particle whizzes in, it's going to spiral because of the magnetic field, but some of them aren't if they're not charged, and it kind of slows them down, traps them, and you use it in science, like in the Large Hadron Collider and things like that. But like embedded in there is the Jane Street logo. They currently have a few educational programs that are accepting applications in both their New York and London offices for pre-university and university students. These programs are part of Jane Street's commitment to give as many people as possible a chance to learn more about what they do. The programs themselves are all a bit different, but focus on topics that you might be interested in. Things like complex mathematical theory, programming, statistics, and more. And it's definitely worth saying you don't need a background in finance to apply. Jane Street is looking for curious people from any background with a passion for technology and creative problem solving. In other words, people like you. Check out the link in the description now to see what opportunities are currently open and to see if any of them might be for you. They currently have 3 programs open in NYC and 1 in London, and applications are closing in just a few weeks. So check out Jane Street today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe. And the algorithm thinks you'll enjoy this video next.